Step up, Beezer, and let the people them know what I'm going in at the heavy metal world right now.
All right, so last Saturday, I went to a festival with an awful, awful name called When We Were Young Festival, but luckily enough, the bill was fucking awesome. So I got there at about 2 o'clock in the afternoon to see the Get Up Kids. The Get Up Kids played half an hour. Virtually everything they played was from Something to Write Home About, an album that we've done on Album Club.
Amazing.
It was... just perfect. Do you know what I mean? The weather's beautiful here all the fucking time. Like the Get Up Kids in the middle of the afternoon playing for half an hour and playing, you know, opening with Holiday and fucking, you know, Action and Action and Red Letter Day and all those fucking songs. Just so, so brilliant. Really cool to see during the day. And then I saw a band that I think are probably the best live band that I've seen of the last few years in terms of new bands. Them and Oathbreaker. Whereas Oathbreaker is like immersive and like being suffocated with a pillow made of diamonds, I think Joyce Manor live are something that everyone needs to see. Yeah. I like this band a lot anyway. Like I like their kind of infectious, like in, out. No songs are long, like very few songs are longer than like two and a half minutes. I've said this a lot this week on social media, but I've been dying to say it here. They're like a Minor Threat Weezer. Like the way that Weezer have choruses for days and brilliant, huge skyscraper level choruses without having to have a big flashy production behind them. But they play their songs live. They play them even faster. So those songs that are super fast anyway go by super fast. You could put this band on a hardcore all day and they would totally hold their own. But those melodies, like for that half an hour, was it, I'm still floored by it now. Bearing in mind that I'm about to talk about the best Alkaline Trio show that I've seen since Good Morning, the first AFI show I've seen in 7 years, and my favourite vocalist of all time being on pretty decent form. The fact that Joyce Manor didn't just steal the day, they fucking ran away with the day, speaks volumes about what I saw. They've just announced a UK tour for July. Steve, like, I kept thinking about you while I was watching it, going, he will fucking love this. Because it's so, mate, it's played so fast and so hard, but the melodies are so fucking infectious. This is a standout live band. It was one of those ones where the set hadn't even finished and I couldn't wait to see him again. Like, fucking unbelievable band. Like, a band that I have sort of 8 out of 10 liked, been raised to a 9 or a 10. Like, I'm truly blown away by Joyce Manor. They're touring with Martha in July. If it's coming near you, because it's a pretty comprehensive UK tour, you've got to see this. You've got to see this. If you like Weezer and you like hardcore music, go and watch this band. Fucking unreal. The Alkaline Trio, it was really nice to see Skibber. Back in the Alkaline Trio. And
awesome.
I've often said about the Alkaline Trio that I think they're the band I like the most that have disappointed me the most live. Skiba sounds incredible these days. I don't know what being in Blink and touring that much has done to him, but like his voice is so much better presently than I've heard it for a long, long time. Dan Adriano as well looked fucking trim as fuck. And the thing that really came off the stage was how much they were enjoying it, which I really haven't got from the Alkaline Trio for a long time. I always go and see them, despite my reservations about them live, because I love their music. But this is the best Alkaline Trio set that I've seen since Good Morning. Really great set list. What you were saying about Parkway Drive earlier. Like the fact that they played for 45 minutes and I could walk away still going. They didn't play This Could Be Love. They didn't play Time to Waste. They didn't play Burn. Like they didn't play Hold Me, Hold Me, Won't You. Like they didn't play that. Fuck me, it was still great. Really, really good. And it was so infectious, you know? Well, I'm going to talk about a band that were fucking truly infectious later on. But when you see them having that much fun up there, and you know that because of the success of Blink and Matt, like, your chances to see the Alkaline Trio are going to be quite fleeting, was really cool to get an opportunity to see them be that play live, full stop, but play live and be that good. Super badass. AFI. Yeah. AFI, so they've not come to the UK for 7 years, so it's been a long-ass time since I've seen them. Do you know what floors me about Davey Havoc, other than fucking everything, is, like, Davey's always been one of the best front men around. He's been that since the very first time I saw him. But the reinvention of Davey Havoc, that he is almost better now than he was back then as a front man, like... The yin and yang between holding his microphone and mic stand and like fucking almost axling it at times, combined with the more visceral nature of the punk stuff, it's that flamboyance and theatricality hand in hand that make him so unique. But he was fucking magnetic. But the band, like, they played Snowcats from the new record in between I Hope You Suffer and Days of the Phoenix, right?
Wow, tough fucking ask. Hell. Yeah, right.
Really held its own. The new stuff from the Blood album sounded bloody brilliant. I'm so excited that I can say this without, like, everyone kind of going, oh, because they're playing Download and because they're doing... the Death sports Tones. Lot for the Deftones. Mm. Yeah. Like, you're going to get the chance to see it. But my God, like, they do this really cool thing with Aurelia that was slightly slowed down. And it made it a little bit more pronounced vocally, more majestic. That plus all of those bangers, 17 Crimes and I Hope You Suffer, both from Burial, sounded fucking insane. So I was really glad I got to see the two standout songs from that record. AFI are on it. One of the best bands of all time, one of the best live bands of all time. You get what you pay for. They turn up, they do that. It was fantastic.
Yeah, amazing.
And then I'll skate over Moz, because I know it's not something that's entirely relevant to this podcast, but he opened with There Is a Light That Never Goes Out into Suedead. What more do you want?
Did you do that? Did you swing the old things around? Yeah.
Fuck off, Stephen.
No, did he though? He loves doing that. It's what he does, isn't it?
That's yes, he did. Yes, he did.
Oh, good.
All of the jutting his chin out and all of the usual huge brilliant stuff.
But right, lovely.
The day belonged to Joyce Manor.
Wow.
Then on Tuesday I went to the Wilton. I thought Wax Idols were kind of cool as an opening band. I think it reflects really brilliantly on a band's front person when the venue is half full and they play like it's a stadium. I really appreciated that. I thought she was a really great front woman. Yeah, I was more impressed. I thought it was impressive enough for a band bottom of a four band bill. But I didn't realise they've got three records out. I was quite impressed when I was like, oh, wow, if this is a new band, it's something to really keep an eye out for. But if it's a band that's three albums in, it's slightly less impressive. Do you know what I mean? It's not like, oh, wow, this band might get it. It's like, oh, okay, this is a band that are clearly quite road worn and are probably in the position that they should be. Like, it was all right.
Fair enough.
Then I owe a massive apology, actually, to this band. I've always been quite lukewarm towards Basement. They've been one of those bands, you know, when you go, kind of what I was saying about North Lane when we reviewed them the other week, one of those bands that I go, I appreciate that lots of people like them, I just don't get it.
Yeah.
Another one, Steve, you'd fucking love this. It's right. Funny, during the set, their frontman said, like, oh, we were last here on tour with Turnstile. And they tread that line between hardcore and 90s alternative rock. And live, it just seems so much more alive than it has done on record. But I have to say, I've gone back to the records since seeing it on Tuesday because I was blown away by how good they were. And I have to say, I think I've misjudged this one. You can't get them all right. Basement are a much, much better band than I've given them credit for. And they were really fucking great. Really, really good.
Like, new album coming as well, isn't it?
Yeah, man. And like for us, oh, they're fueled by ramen now as well. Mm. So like they were third on a 4-band bill, but my God, really, really, really great. Like I was staggered again by how good they were. But they were followed by Touche Amore, who stole the night. Yeah. Absolutely stole the night. Oh, mate, so I looked at their set list and was like, they're playing 14 songs. They must be playing for ages. No, no, they just play their songs really bastard fast.
They do, yeah.
We like, so fast. And we went to see them...
in London.
We went to see them at Islington.
Yeah, yeah.
And I thought it was really good. I thought the crowd were brilliant, but I thought the sound system at Islington Academy did them absolutely no justice whatsoever. I thought that Sound Gremlins that night robbed them of what was a really brilliant performance. Mm. No such worries out here, man. Like, fuck me. They're from Los Angeles as well. So, like... I think that it speaks volumes that they play 14 songs, 6 songs from stage 4, 6 songs from Party the Sea between Brightness and Me. So they're very good judges of their own material. Those are the two standout records, and mm-hmm. they are the two that they pluck most of the live set from. But like to be in Los Angeles, to be singing those songs from stage 4 with that heartbreaking narrative from the album, my Lord. Really fucking, really, really great. And they said that they're coming back in the autumn to do a headline show. So I can't wait for that. I'm not sure. I think they might be on Download.
They are, yeah. They're playing Download.
Right. So if you're going to Download and you like, because the hardcore is so much more evident live. Do you know what I mean?
Oh, definitely.
Like,
yeah.
Definitely. It's way more visceral. Like that the album, Stage 4, like to me, the biggest tie to hardcore music is Jeremy's kind of screamed but emotional vocal. But live, I mean, they play their song so fast. Now the drummer does all of that.
He's
so when
amazing.
They do those, when they do those slow, patient build-ups with the drum roll stuff, but it's done at twice the speed. Wow. Wow. A Thursday, so 1,800 people capacity at the Wilton. Thursday have always meant more in America than they mean in the UK. And seeing them play to a venue that just worshipped them, just from the second they walked on, like they walked on, they opened with For the Workplace Drowning, which is one of my favourite songs of theirs. I love War All the Time. I think it's by far and away my favourite Thursday album. But to see the love in the room, the power of the band, and when some of these bands come back and do these kind of shows, it kind of makes you long for the past and go like, oh, I kind of wish it would have been left in the past. That's Not Metal is powered by Marshall. Join us for new episodes every single Friday featuring the most honest reviews, savage opinions, and everything you need from the world of rock and metal. Go onto iTunes or SoundCloud and search That's Not Metal and subscribe today. Premium podcasts are available at thatsnotmetal.net. Come on over there and get our very best work. thatsnotmetal.net for premium podcasts. That's Not Metal, powered by Marshall, available on iTunes and SoundCloud.